Hi, it's Steve. Today is day 10 of my 30 days of video series and also water fasting at the same time. I'll give a quick update on the fast first. It's still going well. It's definitely getting easier psychologically. Physically, I'm just getting used to the roller coastering of energy. Some days are good. Some days are I just feel really lazy and just lie on the couch most of the day. Yesterday evening was really, really good, but afternoon and morning yesterday was just like tanking energy. This morning, I'm feeling pretty good. Not too bad. One thing I find that helps a lot psychologically with the fast to make it a bit easier is to smell things, like to engage my other senses more, because the sensory deprivation of not smelling food, not tasting food, that can be a little hard. It can feel a little ungrounding psychologically. And, listening to music is also nice, just to give something, some kind of extra sensory input to the ears. Yesterday, when I was out for a walk, I went to Bath & Body Works, was one of the shops in the mall I was walking around, and I just went in there and, like, smelled almost all their scented candles. It just, like, take the lids off and just, you know, inhale the scents. And some of them had, you know, food-like scents, like, oh, this chestnut praline one was so good. And I just wanted to, like, keep sniffing these things. And it's kind of a nice way, you know, it's like you're not eating food, but at least you're getting some extra sensory input, smelling all these different scents. So I actually found that really pleasant to do that. I guess, you know, it's like the fasting version of having a meal, just going around smelling things. Maybe it sounds a bit sad, but you do what you can to cope. And you come, you know, the last time I fasted last year for 17 days, I came up with these different coping mechanisms. And I think one reason this fast is feeling a lot easier than last year's is that I know what to expect, and now also I have this greater level of experience and to have all these little tricks to rely on. So, you know, smelling things is one of those things that helps a lot. My mind, I've noticed, has been feeling a lot clearer, and this has been a similar pattern to what I experienced in last year's fast, is that the first week especially, my mind was a bit foggy. And, cloudy thinking. It was a little harder to concentrate sometimes. But now I'm feeling like it's like a layer of fog that started when I began the fast is lifting. And my mind is feeling clearer. I can think more easily. It's not so bad anymore. So I'm really liking that. And I'm hoping that this coming week, today's Sunday, so I'm hoping this coming week I'll have some more productive days ahead. That will be really nice, because this last week has been pretty, weak on the productivity side. I've done maybe 2-3 hours of work a day, and that's, sometimes maybe just like an hour and a half or so. And I was okay with that. I accepted that going into this. I realized it's a bit of a sacrifice, and it slows me down a bit work-wise, but I'm also going for the greater long-term benefits. Like after a fast like this, you could have potentially higher mental clarity for months, even years afterwards. So I'm going for that long-term gain and maybe a short-term downgrade. But maybe it's not so much of a short-term downgrade for that long if my mind stays clear and my energy stays decent. The last fast I did, after about the first 7 to 10 days, I had some pretty productive days after that. I could work 12 hours a day at my desk and be fine. So, I know every fast is different. I'm hoping, though, that this one kicks into that a bit. So that'd be really nice if that happens. There's a couple interwoven topics I wanted to discuss today. And one is perfectionism, and one is being judged, or being subjected to judgment by other people, and how you deal with those things, how you handle those things. So, I should mention I'm also having breakfast right now, glass of water. And one reason I'm filming this just in my bathrobe in the morning is to show you that you don't have to be perfect, show you that you can just do things in a relaxed and flawed way, and it's okay. There's a difference between perfectionism and high standards. High standards, I think, are good if you're clear about what your standards are and you know why they matter to you and you want to live up to those standards and they're within your grasp. If you set standards that are so high you can't reach them, then you become a bit of a perfectionist, and perfectionism is really just another label for procrastination. And in fact, one of the reasons I'm doing this 30 Days of Video series is to is to get clear about my standards for doing video, like what matters to me and what doesn't, because I wasn't that clear about it when I started. What should I be focusing on in terms of standard if I want to do more videos? And I realized what matters to me most is not flashy production values, not lots of editing, not, you know, making really complicated things. What I want to focus on most is just like sharing a message that matters to people and providing value and getting feedback from people and using that to inform future videos. I want to focus more on the message and the connection. And if I upgrade the production values much later, like probably long after the series, that's something I can work on separately, or I might just outsource that to somebody who has the skills. Because, you know, when I looked into all the things you can do to increase the quality of videos, it can get pretty overwhelming and pretty daunting. And if I got too into that too early, it would just slow me down. You know, perfectionism, I think, is really a misnomer. It doesn't mean you're really striving to be perfect, because that's just ridiculous. You're a human being. Human beings are flawed. You're not going to be perfect. Perfectionism, I think, is just a classier label for procrastination, for fear, for timidity, for cowardice, for holding back, for not taking action, for stagnating. You know, it sounds a bit classier to say, hey, I'm a perfectionist and that's my problem. You know, my standards are so high, it's just taking me a lot of time to reach them. And yet most of the time when I meet perfectionists, you know, so-called perfectionists, they label themselves that way. They're not really taking much action at all, if any. They're just stalling and delaying. They're just vacillating about the idea in their minds, going back and forth about different alternatives, and they're not actually trying anything and doing anything about it. They're giving into fear, and what they're doing is they're presenting a false self-image to other people. They're projecting a mask, and the perfectionism, just that label, is a mask that you put on as a way of excusing yourself from other people's judgment. You're basically saying, you know, like, I'm not going to expose my flaws to you because I don't want to be judged for it, so I'm just going to say that I'm a perfectionist and I'm working on this in private and so on. And, you know, if it takes me a long time, that's because I have really high standards. And that, I think, is just BS. It's nonsense. You know, how do you get past this, though? You know, how do you get over this perfectionism thing? I mean, most of the time, I would say it boils down to some kind of fear about being judged as a flawed human being. Fear of rejection, fear of failure, fear of making mistakes, fear of being seen as someone less than you are, less than you think you are. You have a self-image, basically, that you've built up that's out of alignment with reality, with your current level of performance or skills. And part of the problem is just framing what you're doing as a performance, as if you're trying to impress people. And that is actually the most unimpressive thing of all, is when you're trying to impress people. When you try to impress people, they will tend to see right through you and not be impressed. And people are generally a lot more observant than we give them credit for. They will see through a lot of crap. You know, a lot of times, say, when people are really fake on a stage or really fake in their writing, people see through that, but they try to be kind and they try to give you the benefit of the doubt anyway. but you're not really fooling them. So, you know, you might think you're fooling them, but you're really not. And when you can get people in your audience to a high awareness, you know, conversation, maybe you can even get them to it, you know, admit that. Like, yeah, you know, you were pretty fake up there. Or yeah, that letter you wrote was really, that sales page you wrote was really fake. That blog post you wrote was really fake. That video seemed very stiff and totally not you. You know, ultimately, you want to be the same kind of person when you're in, you know, like if you're a public speaker, you want to be the same person on the stage and off the stage. I think that's the best model to do. And when I see speakers like that, I always think, wow, that's somebody who's congruent. And the key is that they're not afraid of judgment and failure. They're just willing to be themselves. And I think that, you know, that can carry over to many other fields. Being yourself is golden advice. The hard part is that people don't understand what it means to be themselves, because we have all these layers of fears and worries about being judged, and we've developed this mask, this ego we have that we have to protect. And the solution is one you probably won't like, but there's probably multiple ways of solving this. Actually, I know there's multiple ways of solving this. But if you want to make rapid progress, I'll tell you, the fastest way I've seen to solve this is to shatter those fears by just tackling them head on and doing the very thing you're afraid of and exposing the very flaws you're afraid to expose. I've been, you know, on this path of personal growth for many years, and I've done the fake mask thing too. And as I started trying to get past that, I found like so much beauty and so much joy and so much greater ease in life, and so many new opportunities and enrichments in my life opening up as I began just like shedding this fear. One thing I feel really lucky about is that when I started blogging, my traffic ramped up. It ramped up, you know, pretty rapidly, but it happened over a period of years. I mean, it's rapid for like a new business starting, but it happened over a period of years. And so it gave me time to adapt and adjust to the judgment that comes in with getting a lot of attention from other people. I know some people who undergo an experience of like instant overnight celebrity, they freak out with all the judgment that comes to them. And I fortunately was able to develop a tolerance for that over time and be able to handle it, because it started coming in gradually and then it ramped up and then it was like a flood and, you know, crazy things. Like people registered new domains to create new websites just to criticize me. they would burn out after a while. They'd maybe post like 7 critical articles about me, you know, telling me in no uncertain way why I was wrong about everything and why I should quit and all that stuff. Somebody actually registered the URL stevepavlinaisthedevil.com and started posting there. I think that domain has long since expired, but you know, for a few years I think it was up there. And I was just like, seriously? Like, people are that obsessed with me being wrong for them that they have to go to these lengths? And you know, I've had threats, you know, like many other people who have popular blogs. People have threatened violence against me. It's not very common, but it does happen. My ex-wife Erin had a big issue with a crazy stalker who was just like emailing her 10 times a day, had to get the FBI involved. You know, this kind of stuff happens. And so, yes, there is truth that this judgment will happen. If you express yourself as out in the world in some fashion, there will be judgment. But you may not realize fully like where that path can lead and how much of a growth experience it can be, and actually what happens on the other side of that judgment. So I want to share a little bit about that with you. What I've found is that it's the fear of judgment itself that invites more judgment. I'm not entirely certain why that is. I mean, you can explain it in a law of attraction sort of way. Like if you're fearful on the inside, that attracts more judgment. And then when you lose the fear, the judgment no longer comes. That's a convenient explanation, but I find that one a little bit too simplistic. I like explanations where I can see them subjectively and objectively, and like how all the pieces add up and seeing it from different angles and perspectives. And that's one angle that does explain it, does work. But I want to understand this better from other angles too. And that is something I'm still trying to fathom. I see it working in my life and in other people's lives, but I'm not quite sure how or why reality works this way. So I want to explain it more, you know, I want to find a better explanation for this, more in a social way. Like, are other people somehow able to pick up on the fact that you're not going to be deeply affected by their judgment, and so therefore they don't bother? I think there is probably some mechanism there by which we do pick up on that in other people, and that the people who have a fear about being judged, it's almost like we become more tempted, more attracted to the idea of judging those people. I see that in myself too. It's like with friends I have that they're just totally judgment immune. I could criticize them and it'll just blow it off. It wouldn't matter. If I give them positive constructive feedback, they may take that to heart though. But if it's just like trying to be destructive criticism or messing with them, it's not gonna affect them. Whereas other people, and so therefore, I don't even bother doing that, because what would be the point? And with other people who seem like they might be more sensitive to it, it's almost like they're, you know, I have to hold back from this temptation to want to criticize more in those cases, and feel, you know, and be more in a place of compassion. And I see that those people often get subjected to more criticism for what they do, especially the ones that are trying too hard to present a false image. And often those people are their own worst critics. They harsh on themselves the most in private. When you do, I'll share, you know, something you can do to get past the judgment, but what's really fascinating is that when you get past this fear of being judged and this fear of making mistakes and this fear of being rejected, what happens on the other side is a tremendous amount of freedom, because now you can start asking for what you want and expressing things that you couldn't do before. And what's so incredibly odd about that is that you can do things that you would think would invite a lot of judgment, and none shows up. And I mean sometimes just none, or so minimal it just doesn't even matter. You would just blow it off. As an example, several years ago, I think it was in 2010, Rochelle and I had been dating for a few months, and we decided, hey, we wanted to have our first threesome. And so I posted on my Facebook account. I was pretty active on Facebook at the time. I think I posted on my personal Facebook account that Rochelle and I were interested in having a threesome. And I can't recall if there were any judgmental responses, probably just more like people joking with us or something. But some woman who was one of my Facebook friends that I hadn't met before, she said, hey, I'm coming to Vegas in a few weeks. I'll have a threesome with you guys. You know, my boyfriend's going to be with me. I'm in an open relationship. And I was like, oh, okay. So she comes over one night and we have a threesome together. And I was like, that's all it took? It was that easy? I just had to ask for it, you know, and just make that happen. And, you know, after that first one happened, it's like, oh, well, like now we can have this experience again and again if we want. And we have. And it was so much of it was just getting past that self-judgment and realizing, hey, you know what, this could just be a fun, playful thing. If it's, you know, if there's consent and everybody wants to do it, then why not? And you get past all this shame and fear and guilt and the worries about being judged for who you are. But if you have a slutty side and you can accept that and you're not worried about people calling you a slut, whatever, then so what? You know, I have a slutty side, I admit it. And so what? It's like people judge you for that, but you can just let them judge you and you can still have fun. So, it's not really such a big deal after a while. And it got to the point where a few years ago, I was speaking at a dating conference in New York City. And I decided to try a demonstration because I'd noticed that the judgment I was getting about certain things that was once really high had just been going down and down and down and down and down. Like it was just disappearing. And it seemed to track my own self-judgment. The less I judged myself and the more I accepted myself as I was, the less other people came after me and had anything to judge about me. And it was weird. So I thought, you know, I'm gonna do something a little bold here. I'm gonna test this in front of a live audience. So I had about, I think somewhere over 30,000 Twitter followers at that time. And I decided to post to my Twitter account. Again, this is going out to, you know, tens of thousands of accounts. I posted in front of the audience, and this was a demonstration at a dating conference, and I was talking about this judgment thing and getting congruent with who you are and what your desires are and what you like. And I posted that I love threesomes, and then I just tweeted that. And I actually posted I heart threesomes and then sent that. And I asked the audience to predict, you know, like what kind of responses am I going to get? And some people are, of course, thinking, oh, geez, you know, with that many people, you're going to get some pretty negative feedback. I was speaking again there the next day, and I shared the results. And since this was done publicly, anybody else could get on their cell phones and look at the results too. They could verify this with me. And people pulled out their phones, and I was asking, okay, what are the responses? What kind of things are people tweeting back to me? One person said, me too. One person said, good for you. All of the responses were either neutral or they were positive, like even encouraging. There wasn't a single negative response, you know, among all those replies, not one. Now, if I had done this years earlier, I am sure I would have got a flood of negative responses for doing that kind of thing. But because I became congruent with that type of experience and I was no longer afraid of judgment about it, people didn't bother. And it's really strange how that happens. So the key here, I think, with overcoming perfectionism and overcoming this fear of judgment, you know, let's talk about how to do that. And this is the part, again, I don't think you're going to like. And the part, you know, the real key here is that you want to desensitize yourself to the judgment. I think it helps to build up your tolerance for it and to gradually see that, yes, you can be fully yourself. You can express all your desires, all your weirdness, all your shameful experiences, your fearful experiences, and just get that out there and not be afraid of what other people think. Make yourself more vulnerable to the world. Allow that to happen. And what you gain is greater connection with people. What you gain is the ability to have much more intimacy in your life and connecting with people who are real and who see you as you are and not having to wear that mask and not having to deal with all these shallow relationships anymore. You can have real depth and meaning in your social life so much more. You'll meet people who, you know, because of who you are, even if they don't know, you know, like even if people have never read my blog or anything like that, I'm just meeting them for the first time, because of the journey I've taken on this path, people will feel so comfortable with me, they'll just open up and tell me their deepest, darkest secrets, their life stories right away. And I love that because I'm the same way. I'll do that with people too. And sometimes they're initially surprised that I can just be so open about things that people would normally hide about themselves. But people warm up to that really quickly because I think we all crave that kind of deeper connection. And you can make really good friendships in just a few hours or sometimes even minutes that way. There's a lot of different ways to go about this. I'll give you one example. So my friend Sasha was a dating coach. He helps people get over some of their fears of rejection, humiliation, and embarrassment by forcing them to be rejected and humiliated and embarrassed in public. So he'll take them out. He'll take a group of people out, say for a weekend, and he'll make them do crazy, ludicrous, ridiculous things in public. Like go walk through a supermarket screaming into their cell phone like they're having an argument with somebody and just, you know, go up and down the aisles doing that. Go to a Starbucks and smash their face against the window, you know, staring at the people right behind the window until the manager comes and kicks them out. Pick their nose while they're starting a conversation with somebody, you know, walk up to somebody on the street, start a conversation while picking their nose the entire time, and then offer a handshake afterwards. you know, just again and again, doing ridiculous, embarrassing things until they get over there. Until, you know, Sasha says, you know, he does this to destroy people's egos. And by the time they're done, you know, after a couple days of that, they're no longer afraid because they've just shed all that worry about the embarrassment. They've just gone through it. They've done it again and again and again, multiple times each day. And now they get to the point where it's fun. And Sasha would be telling these people afterwards to like, hey, let's go talk to some women and work on your connection skills. And the guys would be like, no, I want to keep doing more crazy stuff because they get so into it. Once they get past the fear, now it actually becomes fun. And that's something that's really, you know, amazing. It's like when you experience that freedom and that fun on the other side of fear, it enriches your life so much and you just want to keep doing more of it. As another example, my friend Fred, who is one of the people who recorded the Imaginary Men audio program with me. Fred was diagnosed with social anxiety disorder. He had the paperwork and everything, the diagnosis, and he was, you know, very timid about talking to people. And he decided he wanted to overcome that. And so what he did is he got this idea from somebody else, but he basically dressed a little crazy. I think he put his underwear on outside of his clothes and he made a sign and put it on his shirt and it said something like, I am the biggest idiot in the world. And he walked around in public doing that. He's Norwegian and he did this in Oslo, Norway. He just walked around the streets doing that. And it was, you know, he said it was a little scary at first, but he got more and more confident with it as he went along and people started connecting with him. And he realized, wow, this is like people are talking to me and it's not as bad as I thought. And that got him on a path of wanting to do even more of that. Like once he started getting into this, he wanted to push himself more and more and see how far he could go with just overcoming all these fears and becoming braver socially. And so he got involved with a couple other people and started a YouTube channel together doing all these social pranks. And then Fred branched out and started his own channel on YouTube and basically just started doing, you know, crazy prank after crazy prank and finding ways to just be like totally fearless in public. And one of his most amazing videos is Fred. Fred did this in Oslo, Norway. He would take all his clothes off and go talk to people completely naked and start conversations. And he filmed that and he put it on YouTube. In fact, I was in Oslo with Fred and my other friend Luke when they were doing this. And I was sitting at a coffee shop there working on my laptop. And Luke comes down one day and he said, "Steve, I just spent the past 6 hours editing Fred Schlong out of videos." He's like, "I don't know if," and we still have like another 6 hours to go. He's like, "Kill me now." And I'm thinking, oh man. So, Fred, in fact, Fred and I spoke at the same conference at Sasha's event, because we all know each other, Sasha's event in London last year. And Fred gave this talk, sharing about how he overcame his social phobia and shared this in front of the audience. And at the end of his speech, he took all his clothes off and walked off the stage naked. And I'm just like, really, Fred? But, that's an example of just how far you can go with overcoming your fears and your worries and your anxieties. It's really hard, I'll say, to do this on your own. Almost always it helps to have somebody pushing you, encouraging you to do this. I've done some of these types of exercises with people at the conscious growth workshops. The first years I did that, especially in 2010, I would have people go out into, we would do those workshops. I think most of those were at the Flamingo Hotel, so right in the middle of the Las Vegas Strip. And we'd have people for about a half hour leave the conference room, go out into the casino onto the Vegas Strip, and just do crazy social approaches. And I'd have people do, I'd give people a list of about 50 different exercises they could do. And these are really short ones, like usually taking just a few seconds, sometimes less than a minute. And they might be things like, go skipping down the street, or try to start a spontaneous dance party with total strangers. Some of them were simple, like just make eye contact with somebody as you walk by, or smile as you walk by. And before we'd go out, I'd have everybody rate these on a scale of 1 to 3. As to how difficult they thought they would be. So a 1 was like, okay, I could do this right now. That's not that difficult for me. A 2 was, that's a bit tough, but I think I could do that, especially if I have some people encouraging me. And a 3 is, no way, I couldn't do that. And we'd do this for about a half hour each day, and we'd do it in groups of 3. So you'd have 2 people encouraging you, and you'd take turns doing these crazy things for about 10 minutes each. And after the first time we went out, I'd ask people, how it went. And about half the people, in just that first 10 minutes of trying, they'd already completed at least one of their 3s. So social support, having some encouragement really helps. And it was a really freeing experience. And some people took this experience like crazy far. I remember there was one guy who kept working on it in the evenings, and at one of these workshops. And he was a Southern preacher, if I recall. And he was like, I have a lot of experience in front of audiences. I can do all these. But there was one. He was like, I've done all these except for one. And there's like one I can't seem to do. And I was like, which one is it? And he said, it's the one where I have to like pretend I'm talking to an imaginary friend as I'm walking around, around other people. And I said, okay. I said, well, you want to do it now? Let's all go down there. Let's do it together. And so I go down with him, and we were just like in the Flamingo Casino. And he just like, all right, I'm doing it. And he just did way over the top with that. He like backed, he was like put his arm around an imaginary friend. It was like having a really animated conversation with him as he's walking around past all the slot machines. And, he just found that was so freeing afterwards to get all those done, and how amazing it was. And again, this is a really tough thing to do on your own. It really helps to hang out more with people who have high levels of social courage. And you'll probably find, if you're of that perfectionist mindset, that these people scare you, that you tend to avoid them. And I would encourage you to do the opposite of that, to start embracing more of these people and bring them closer into your reality. The more I've done that, the more it's encouraged me to just get past all this crap and all these worries. There are some really strong benefits that can accrue when you begin to express your real self. Back many years ago, like the first year or two I started blogging, I started writing more about some of my, you know, shameful stories from my past, like all the shoplifting I did. I remember, I think it was in 2005, I wrote this article. I wrote the series called The Meaning of Life. And the first article was titled The Meaning of Life Intro. I shared at length my crazy stealing story and how I got kicked out of school. And somebody, you know, and I thought, you know, I was like clicking the publish button like this. Because I was like, no, I can't believe I'm going to publish this. Now, it wasn't really a secret. Like, my friends and family all knew that. But it's not something I'd ever posted on the internet before. And I thought, if I post it on the internet, it's not coming down. You know, it's out there for good then. So I published it. And very shortly afterwards, I started getting really positive feedback. And that surprised me. I thought I would get some really harsh negative feedback. Like, oh, you criminal. You know, I can't believe I'm reading the work of an ex-con. This is crazy. You know. I'm like, wow, this is like really supportive. People are just like saying that it took a lot of courage to share that. And thank you for being so vulnerable. And I really appreciate that. And I'm going to keep reading your work from now on. And I love this. And I encourage you to do more of this. And I thought, wow, it's like I was connecting with people in a deeper way. And there was one email in particular that really touched me. It was from a teenage boy. And he said, I really love that you shared that because I'm going through an experience like that right now, but I'm in the thick of it. I'm, you know, doing all this criminal stuff and I'm just addicted to it and it's crazy and I could tell it's going to ruin my life. And he said, Steve, you gave me hope that I can get past this. You showed me what life could be like on the other side when I eventually stop. And he's like, I'm going to work on getting out of this. And I thought, wow, that's, you know, that's really cool. And a little later on, I think that same year, I got a letter in the mail from somebody who was, I think in his late teens, early 20s, and it was a guy who said he was suicidal. And he was searching, he said he was up late one night and he just decided he'd had enough and he was going to kill himself. And he said he'd already attempted suicide before, but he said this time he was certain he was just going to do it. And so he was searching online for a good way to kill himself. And he began, you know, searching, and somehow in the process, he stumbled across my blog, and I'm not sure how he did that because I haven't written anything about preventing suicide. But he came across my website, and he said he read for 6 hours straight, like all through the night. And by the time he was done, he said no longer did he not want to kill himself, but he wanted to, you know, he's thinking about this as a lesson for other people in terms of his life purpose and how he could help others. And he said he was really going to work on that. And I thought, wow, it's like my, you know, because of sharing this vulnerable side of myself and connecting more with people and not trying to put up a social mask as much, you know, maybe my work has saved a life. And since then, I've gotten many emails like that. I'm thinking, wow, it's like some people might actually be dead if I didn't do this type of inner work. And so that really, you know, raises the bar a lot for, you know, making sure that I keep that part of my standard going and not try to, you know, not try to be a perfectionist. Just to record a message in a bathrobe, you know, in the morning, while fasting, you know, do it whenever you can. Just, it's like, it's so much more important, I think, to express and connect from our hearts and not get stuck in our heads with all the overanalysis. The polish is not a bad thing. It can come later if you're capable of it and if it doesn't slow you down. But if you're using it as something, you know, to basically squash your productivity, to hold yourself back, that's when you're getting into trouble. You know, if you have issues with judgment, I think it really helps to start building up some immunity to that, starting in some small way, doing the very thing that you feel you'll get judged for and inviting that judgment deliberately. I wrote an article many years ago called Share Your Shame. And it's about this very thing. And some people took that to heart and they started sharing their shameful experiences in public. And they found the same thing I did, that it actually invites greater connection. And yes, the more resistance you have to it, the more it might invite some judgment, but eventually you start getting used to that. And the more you accept that the judgment is not really about you, that it's about the other person, it's about their issues, it's about what you're triggering in them and about what you represent to them. It's not really that personal, especially judgment coming from strangers over the internet who don't even know you, who haven't even met you. You know, it's easier not to take it so personally. I think Dr. Wayne Dyer had a great solution to this. I had the privilege of meeting him many years ago before he passed away. And he had a great solution for dealing with critical feedback. And he would, you know, he'd write something and he'd get like one email that was just lavishing praise on him for his genius, and another email that would be scathing criticism. And what he would do is he would just take each email and forward it to the other person and with a message, you could be right. And I thought, that's a brilliant response. You know, that just like shuts down all criticism, is you could be right. You could be right. And I used that for a while. You know, like somebody would send me a huge critical email, like 1,000 words filled with Bible quotes telling me why I was going to hell and all that. And I would just write back, you could be right. And a while after that, I found an even better response that that worked great. For one, people can't argue with you could be right. So how do they attack that? How do they, you know, like pretty much nobody ever writes back. It just shuts down the argument. But what I like responding with these days is I just reply with a smiley face, if I reply at all. I mean, you can ignore it too, but sometimes I just like to write back with a smiley face. So somebody knows like, hey, you know, your criticism is acknowledged, but I'm just smiling at you. And I also use the smiley face more broadly. Like if I don't have time to type a lot, you know, some people send to me really long messages and I don't have time to respond to that. So I don't always just use this for criticism. I'll just use that to acknowledge I read it. But, you know, I smile. That's it. And that works really well too. It is a long-term path to, you know, to follow this. You can do this, you know, desensitization process in a crazy weekend like my friend Sasha does, or what Fred did with just like pushing it very, very far. But I think the real key is just to get to the point where it's no longer limiting you. And it's no longer stopping you from expressing yourself as a flawed human being, imperfectly, providing value for people. And it, you know, it's a journey. When I did my first workshop in 2009, I spent 30 days preparing for it, preparing the content, preparing the delivery. That's not counting the logistics. That's just preparing, you know, the material. And that was based on my book, which I'd already written. So I'd already written the content that it was based on, you know, at least the core ideas. And still another 30 days to prepare for it, for a 3-day event. And that's because I was thinking I had to, you know, get everything just right. And then when I actually got up there on the stage and found, you know, I'd over-prepared and it was coming out more stiffly than I liked, I lightened up on that for the next workshops. And now it's at the point where I can prepare a 3-day workshop in about 3 days. So it's 10 times faster. And the main difference is that I'm not as concerned about making a mistake. I'm not as concerned about stumbling or, you know, rambling too much in one place. It's not as big a deal because now my focus is more on the audience, on the people, on the connection, on sharing value for them, and not so much on being stuck in my head and the ideas. I want to be more present when I'm sharing. And that's a real key. And shedding that fear of judgment and the worries and the nervousness, that all goes away. And, you know, it's like I don't get nervous when I do public speaking these days because, I'm not worried about the embarrassment and humiliation because I focus more on the playfulness and the fun, the connection. To me, it's not a performance, it's a conversation. But, you know, again, it's a long-term journey. And you can take your time doing this or you can try to do it really rapidly if you feel like pushing yourself. But, you know, keep it in mind. You know, don't use this perfectionism label on yourself so much. Just call it what it is. It's fear. And it's you know, worries and concern about being judgment. And it's an irrational fear. Yes, the people who, you know, who don't like your message, don't like what you're about, they will reject you. But if you just unabashedly express yourself as you are, that rejection will be over really quickly, because they'll just excuse themselves from your life and they'll move on, because you won't budge. You'll just be yourself. But if you're constantly trying to coddle them and cater to them and dampen who you are to appeal to them, they're going to linger around and that criticism will just go on and on and on and on, because you'll constantly be giving them inroads. And you'll constantly be giving them hope that you'll change to become who they want you to be instead of being who you really want to be. And if you just squash that hope, just say, you know, screw it, I'm not going to be like you. I'm going to be myself. I'm listening to you, I get that, but it's not me. And if you make that really patently obvious, they'll either accept that about you or they'll just dump you and move on. And either way, you're free. So, you know, it's important to make mistakes, to explore, to find out who you really want to be, and to learn how to express yourself authentically on your human journey through life. It'll lead to, you know, being able to express more creativity, being able to contribute more, and especially being able to attract a social circle that likes you as you are. Because the ones who don't, they'll leave. They'll excuse themselves because they'll see there's no point in trying to, you know, push on you so much. So, I hope this gives you some food for thought about ways to overcome the fear of judgment and, get started on that journey. Get moving on it. Start working on it. I'll see you tomorrow.